Hello and welcome to another lecture in Introduction to Machine Learning. Today we will extend our discussion about support vector machines. So we will cover two topics. One is kernelized support vector machines. So that helps us develop nonlinear classifiers and regressors. But up till now we have only talked about SVM in the context of classification, binary classification. So we will also introduce support vector regression. So the learning objectives for this module are, we will derive the dual form of support vector machine, and that dual form will allow us to represent data as kernels. We will replace pairs of data points by kernels, and that will bring non-linearity into the classification or the regression task that we are planning to do. And we will also derive support vector regression objective, which we haven't covered until now. Alright, so first let's motivate the idea of a kernel. Some of it we have already seen in the previous lectures, that linear classification, for example, is not always adequate to separate two different classes for binary classification. Let's take another example. So let's say we have two features. We have feature X1 and we have feature X2, right? And these features are the two classes are spread out in this feature space as follows. So let's say we have the positive class, which is concentrated like this, and then we have negative classes, which are concentrated on the two sides of the positive class. So there is no linear boundary that can separate these two classes. Now, but if I transform this feature space into another space, right? So I do a transform, and let's call this transform phi, right? And in that, let's say I have two different axes now. The axes now are phi1 and phi2, right? So what is phi? Phi is basically a function of x that transforms x into new variables phi1 and phi2. So phi1 and phi2 are the two features. It could be actually more than two features, but we will, for this illustration, we will take only two features. And the objective would be that we transform it into a new space where the data is linearly separable. So let's see how we can do that. One way of doing that would be that what we will do is we'll define a radial basis function. So what is a radial basis function? So let's say we take this particular sample, and we take this particular sample, and for this sample, let's call this x1, not to be confused with the dimension x1, but let's say it is point x1. So let's say your phi1 is going to be exp, so it's a Gaussian kernel of x minus x1. Okay, we will take the L2 norm of that, we will square it, and we will divide it by some constant. Okay, so let's call it 2 sigma square. Okay, so this is your first feature, and the second feature is phi2, which is this exp of, so what is this phi? It's a function of x. Similarly, phi2 is also a function of x. And this is similarly x minus x2 divided by, so there's a negative sign here, negative 2 sigma square. Okay, then let's say that sigma is fixed. It's a hyperparameter. Okay, it's a fixed hyperparameter. And x1 and x2 are not these two dimensions, x1 and x2. This is not what we are talking about. We are talking about these two points. So this point is x1 and this point is x2. Okay, so this is x1 and x2 as a vector x1 and x2, not as a dimension x1 and x2. Alright. So for every other point x, right, we will take the distance from this point and the distance from this point, and we will fit a Gaussian kernel on that. So this is the Euclidean distance that we are looking at, x minus x1 and x minus x2. Okay. So if you look at that, what will happen is that in the phi2 space, what will happen to all these negative points? They will have a very high phi2. right? Because they are close to these points are close to x2 point, so they will have a high phi 2. Okay, so why? Because your when your distance is small, your Gaussian kernel will give you a high value. So they will these points will fall somewhere here. Okay, and they will have a low phi 1 because they are far away from the x1. Okay, on the other hand, these points are going to have a high phi 1 and a low phi 2. So these points will fall here. Okay, these points will have both low phi 1 and low phi 2 because they are all far away from this particular point. So they will all fall here. Now what I can do is I can actually have a linear boundary that can separate this data. Okay, so with some transformation I can have linear boundaries that can separate the data, which in otherwise what I would have needed is some sort of a non-linear boundary. So this non-linear boundary itself translates to a linear boundary in the new space. Okay, so that is the objective of using kernel functions. Now here if you notice that this particular function phi is defined in terms of actually two data points. One is the data point on which we want to compute the feature, and the second is the data point on which is a sort of a referral data point. So now you can see where I'm getting at, that these referral data points are going to be the support vectors, but after we take some transformation. So this brings us to the summary of what we have just discussed. Why we want to use a kernel, why we want to use a nonlinear transform, because with the right kernel, we can increase the dimension of the feature. Okay, instead of x, let's say it is two dimensions, we can actually introduce many phis, many different features, and the vector of features can have a much larger dimension than the vector of the raw inputs x. So now your input to the SVM is going to be not the raw input x, but the feature input, which is phi. Okay, and then it can be transformed into a space where it is linearly separable. So the example that we had already given was that we have some negative samples here, some positive samples here, and some negative samples here. So if this is x space, we transform it into using a transform into phi space, okay, where we have the negative samples here, here, and the positive samples here, so that we can linearly separate that. Now it's possible that sometimes you need more than two dimensions of features to get that linear separability, right? So for example, if I take a different approach, if I take a different sort of data, right? So let's say my data is such that I have positive samples that are concentrated near the origin, and I have negative samples all around it, right? So now I have x1, I have x2, and I represent phi, right? So now phi of x, let's say phi of x, okay, is a vector which is x1, x2, and then x1 square plus x2 square, okay, and square root. So this is a three dimensional feature now, where in the phi space I have phi 1, okay, which is same as x1, I have phi 2, which is same as x2, and then I have phi 3, which is the third dimension, okay, and that third dimension basically is how close are we to the origin. So in that third dimension, basically, if I just look at the third dimension, let's say I want to plot now phi 1 versus phi 3, because I cannot adequately show the three dimensions. Let's say I want to show phi 1 versus phi 3, then the data points that I will have, they will be concentrated like this. Okay, and if there is a circle that can separate the positive and the negative classes, in the phi 1, phi 3 or phi 1, phi 2, phi 3 space, it will be a line. So below that, all the points are closer to the origin in the x1, x2 space. Above that, all the points are further away from the origin in the x1, x2 space. So I have a linear boundary in phi 1, phi 2 and phi 3 space. So it will be a linear hyperplane. I'm not drawing the phi 2 dimension, but that will be able to separate the data. So many times we need a lot of dimensions. We need to transform the data into multiple dimensions to be able to find a linear boundary, possibly even infinite dimensions. Okay, so now that brings us to another point of what is a kernel, right? So kernel will be a function of two data points. It will not be a function of a single data point. So it will be a function of xi and xj. Okay, so this I'll write this as bold because these are vectors. These are not dimensions, these are vectors. So it's a function of two different data points with the following properties: that it is symmetric, and it measures some sort of a similarity between xi and xj. That means it will likely have high value when xi and xj are the same, and it will have low value when xi and xj are very different from each other. Now, having said that, there is another property that we want this kernel to have, that it will form a positive semi-definite Gram matrix. So let's say I define a matrix K, right? And in this matrix K, I have K x1 x2, K x1 x1, okay? And I have K of xn xn. What is xn? Any points, any number of points n. Any number of points from the original space, okay? And a general element is k xi xj. That's a general element of this matrix. This matrix is going to be positive semi-definite. What does that mean? That all its eigenvalues will be non-negative. So that means this will have non-negative eigenvalues. So if we select a kernel function that encodes similarity in such a way that any Gram matrix that we find, that we form for any number of points, any n number of points taken from that space, and all those matrices are positive semi-definite, then this is a kernel that can be used in an SVM. So it is called a reproducing kernel Hilbert space. And basically what has been shown is, or it is called a Mercer kernel. Mercer kernel. So what has been shown is that this K xi xj is actually some feature of xi transpose, or its dot product taken with the same feature of xj. What is that phi? We don't know that yet. Okay, if we define just a kernel, and that kernel is going to be it satisfies this property that its Gram matrix is going to be positive semi-definite, then there exists a phi. Okay, there exists a phi for which the kernel function can be represented as a dot product of two features, and that phi can have infinite dimensions even. So an example of that is precisely the kernel that we looked at before, which is the Gaussian kernel or the radial basis function kernel. So it can be example, we can have kxi xj is equal to exp of minus xi minus xj. Okay, take the L2 norm of that, square that, okay, and divide it by some positive constant. Some positive constant, doesn't matter what that constant is. 2 doesn't matter, the square doesn't matter, it just has to be multiplied with some positive constant. So I can even like delete this and say that let's multiply this with some constant k, kappa, not k, let's not confuse it. So it's some constant kappa. Okay, so this is a Mercer kernel. We can show that if we form any matrix of any size, okay, using induction, we can start with, let's say, a matrix of size 2, and then by induction we can show that if we increase the matrix of matrix by 1, it is still going to be a positive semi-definite matrix. So it's going to be the matrix is going to be the Gram matrix is going to be This is the Gram matrix. Gram matrix is going to be positive semi-definite, and because of that, it can be represented as a dot product of two features of X, and the dimension of that two features is possibly infinite. It can be more than the dimension of X itself. Okay. So that is the more important part. So now what does this point to is that we want to now change the equation of the SVM such that it can be represented as Xi transpose Xj as opposed to X. We want to only have dot product terms in the objective function or in the solution of the support vector machine. Once we can represent it using this, we can replace X with any phi of X, and we can replace the dot product with a kernel. Okay, so that gives us a lot of flexibility in designing nonlinear support vector machines. So the nonlinearity of the boundary was clear from the previous examples, where we showed that in the new feature space the boundaries are still linear, but in the original X space the boundaries are now nonlinear. Okay, so just a little bit of a word about the Gaussian kernel. Let's go back to this particular figure. So basically what this function is encoding is some sort of a relative distance from, or some sort of a function of a distance from some key points, and this property has been exploited before in RBF or radial basis function networks, which is a form of a neural network which we will look at later. So basically it goes back to something called kernel based estimation of functions. So let's say we have a regression, we have some regression data. So we have X here and we have the target value T here, right? And we are given several points, all right, which are T and X. They are pairs of T and X, and we want to estimate a function that smoothly interpolates these points so that for other X's for which the training data is not given, we are able to estimate the T, right? So one way to do that is to say that let's take all these points, okay, and on all these points what we will do is we will fit a kernel function. What is a kernel function? It's some sort of a localized function, right? And this function is basically the same everywhere except that it is shifted to different training points, okay? And we will sum these shifted versions of the same function. But before we do that, we will scale this one up. We will scale this lesser. We will scale this up to this point. We will scale this up to this point, and so forth. So now once we scale these points, what we get is slightly different functions. So we get something like this, right? And when we add all of them up, the linearly scaled versions of the function, when we add them up, we get some smooth interpolated function. Okay, and that smooth interpolated function is basically nothing but it is so your f of x now is sum over of I is equal to 1 to n, right? Some constant kappa I, or let's say ai, times this function k of x comma xi. Okay, what is k of x comma xi? That's precisely the Gaussian kernel that was sitting, which are the yellow Gaussian functions that were so it's going to be the shifted Gaussian function, and it is shifted by the amount xi. Okay, so if we use this formula, we are able to smoothly interpolate it. We can, if these points are regularly spaced, we can have a triangular kernel which basically is the basis of linear interpolation and so forth, right? So we can have linear interpolation between these points and so forth. So there are different kernels that will give you different smoothness effects, or different kind of they are based on different kind of assumptions, right? And we can even so basically what we are doing in SVM is we are not going to use all the training points the way we are using it here. We are going to use a sparse set of points, right? And that sparseness is precisely taking out all the points that are not support vectors. So we are getting towards that, but before we get towards that, we want to change the form of the equation of the support vector machine and introduce dot products, which we will replace by kernels. We want to introduce dot products between some x and some other x, xi and xj, and we replace it with a kernel k of xi and xj. So that precisely is the kernel trick. So this kernel trick is going to make it's going to take linear problems, and it's going to still keep them linear by introducing a non-linearity in the form of a kernel. So what we will do is we'll try to change the equation, which is the primal form of support vector machine that we have already seen, and we will change it into a dual form. In dual form, there will be no single xi or single x. It will all be in terms of dot products. Either so you can either think of it as xi transpose xj for some I and j, or x transpose xi or x transpose xj, etc. But we will not have single terms of x. So once we have that, what we will do is we will assume that any dot product can be replaced by a feature vector, right? And because these feature vectors can now even be infinite, as long as what we compute is a scalar, right? So this kernel gives you a single value of comparison of xi and xj, or phi xi and phi xj. So this the output of this kernel is going to be a scalar. As long as we can take these dot products and get scalars, right? And because this dot product already satisfies this Mercer kernel property, we can replace it by any kernel that satisfy the Mercer kernel property, which means that its Gras matrix is a positive semi-definite. So we will use that, and that is called the kernel trick. We will replace all the dot products with a kernel.